Thank you so much. It's a great, great honor to be in this space with you. I'm so thrilled that there's a conference somewhere that uses the phrase people of color in the title of the conference. I think that's really exciting. I think it's really important. And I think it's necessary. And I'm particularly proud to be here because I know there are many of you in this room who believe that we need to change the world. And I believe we need to change the world, and I think we can change the world. There are some challenges that we are facing in this nation. There are challenges that we're facing in education. We're facing challenges with regard to poverty and bias and discrimination. I see huge challenges in the American criminal justice system. In 1972, we had 300,000 people in jails and prisons. Today, we have 2.3 million people in jails and prisons. The United States has become the most punitive place on the planet. We've got the highest rate of incarceration in the world. 6 million people on probation or parole. 70 million Americans have criminal arrests, which means that when they try to get a job or try to get a loan, they're often disfigured. We've done terrible things to women. In the last 20 years, the percentage of women going to prison has increased 646% just in the last 20 years. 70% of the women that we send to jails or prisons are single parents with minor children, which means that when these women go to jail or prison, their children get displaced. We've done terrible things to people when they come out of prison. Last year, the president came to my state of Alabama, and he came to Selma to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery March, and 80,000 people came, and members of Congress came, and they marched across the Edmund Pettus Bridge to commemorate the historic march that led to the Voting Rights Act, but very few of them realized that today in Alabama, 30% of the black male population has permanently lost the right to vote as a result of felon disenfranchisement. The statistic that keeps me up latest at night, though, is the one from the Bureau of Justice. The Bureau of Justice now predicts that 1 in 3 black male babies born in this country is expected to go to jail or prison. 1 in 3. That was not true in the 20th century. That was not true in the 19th century. It has become true in the 21st century. The statistic for Latino boys is 1 in 6. And yet there is no conversation about this. We don't think of that as a crisis. We're not talking about that in these elections. We're not talking about that at the highest levels of government. Even the Department of Education isn't talking about it the way I think we need to be talking about it. So I think we need to change things. I think we need to change the world. We need to change this country and the way it responds. And I can spend all my time talking about the problems, but I don't want to do that. I want to talk about the solutions. I think there are 4 things that if we do, if we come together and reflect upon and then do, I believe we can change things. The first is that I am persuaded that if you want to change the world, you've got to get proximate to the people and the places where there's inequality and injustice. You cannot change the world from a distance. We've got a lot of policymakers trying to change things from a distance, and when you're far away, your solutions don't work. If you really want to make a difference, you've got to get close to the problems. There are nuances and details to the problems of children living in impoverished communities. There are challenges for kids living in the margins of our societies. There are challenges for our students that are coming from families where there's abuse and neglect and despair. And if we don't get close to these communities, these children, these families, we will not have effective policies to help these young people. Proximity is essential if we're going to change things. Most of us have been taught our whole lives that if there's a part of town where the schools don't function very well, if there's a part of town where there's a lot of violence and abuse and neglect, if there's a part of town where there's a lot of despair, you should stay as far away from that part of town as possible. But this morning I'm going to argue that we should do the opposite. I believe we've got to get closer to the parts of our community where there's suffering and inequality and despair and abuse and violence. We've got to get closer to the people who are undocumented and hiding in the shadows, marginalized by disability and abuse. We've got to get closer to the people who experience inequality and injustice the most. And when we get proximate, I'm going to tell you, we become powerful. I think there's power in proximity. You don't have to have the answers to get proximate. You've just got to go. And when you go, you'll find that you have power that you didn't realize you had. I'm the product of someone's choice to get proximate. I grew up in a community where black children could not go to the public schools. I started my education in a colored school.
And when I was a little boy, they didn't let black kids go to the public schools. There were no high schools for black children in my county when my dad was a teenager. And then lawyers came into our community and they made them open up the public schools. And because lawyers came to my community and got proximate to poor black kids like me, I got to go to high school. And I have no illusions about the fact that I would not be standing here if those lawyers had not chosen to get proximate. But because they chose to get proximate, I got to go to high school. I graduated from high school, and then I got to go to college. Nobody had graduated from my family. No one in my family had gone to college and graduated, and so when I got to college, it was like stepping into this whole new world. I was very active in music. I was very active in sports. I went to college in Pennsylvania at this beautiful campus, and I was just stunned by how stimulating it was. To be honest, I loved college. And I was one of these really quirky, not very socially sophisticated college students. And I remember waking up one morning and just realizing that I loved college. And I actually said aloud to myself, I said, I love college. And I went into the cafeteria and I sat down with my friends and I said, you know what? I realized that I love college. And then I turned to my friends and I said, I'm going to spend the rest of my life in college. My friends got up and walked away. And I was still so excited, I picked up the phone and I called my mom. I said, Mom, I've made a decision. I'm going to spend the rest of my life in college. And my mother said, I didn't go to college, but I don't think they're going to let you do that. I said, no, Mom, they will. And I was a philosophy major in college. And so by the time I was a senior, I thought as a philosophy major, I was supposed to go out and think these deep thoughts. And I went out on the hillside sometimes, and I would just sit there and think of my so-called deep thoughts. And one day I was out there, and somebody walked up to me and said, you know, you're a senior, and you're a philosophy major. What are you going to do when you graduate from college? And I heard this as a very hostile question, because I realized nobody was going to pay me to philosophize when I graduated from college. So I frantically tried to figure out how to stay in school. And because nobody in my family had graduated from college, I didn't know that in this country, if you want to do graduate work in history or English or political science to get admitted to graduate school, you actually have to know something about history, English, or political science. I was very intimidated by this. I kept looking, and to be honest, that's how I found law school. It was very clear to me, you don't need to know anything about law. Deeply disillusioned. Because I went there because I was concerned about racial inequality, I was concerned about poverty, I was concerned about social injustice, and it didn't seem like anybody was talking about race or poverty or injustice. I said, this isn't for me, and I finished my year at the Harvard Law School, and then I went to the Harvard School of Government. I decided to get a degree in public policy. I thought that would be better for me. And I started my year there. I'd been there a couple of months, and I woke up one morning and I looked in the mirror and I thought, I'm even more miserable here than I was at the law school. They were teaching us to maximize benefits and minimize costs, but it didn't seem to matter whose benefits got maximized and whose costs got minimized. And I finished my year there, and I went back to the law school, and I was about to do this thing I hope none of you ever do. I was about to do this thing where I tried to rationalize pursuing a career in law that I knew was not going to be fulfilling. I tried to persuade myself that I could take a job that I didn't really believe in, that I knew was not going to be affirming, not going to be connected to what was in my heart, and then I got proximity. I took a course that required me to spend a month working with a human rights organization in Atlanta, Georgia, this city, and I came to Atlanta, and I met these lawyers who were representing people on death row, and I was stimulated and inspired by these lawyers whose lives were animated by the work they did. Our office was just across the street from where we're sitting here right now. In fact, I'd been there a week and I was getting hopeful. One of the lawyers said, we need you to go to death row and just meet somebody we haven't had time to meet. Just go down there and explain to him that he's not at risk of execution anytime in the next year. And I never will forget leaving from close by and driving down to Jackson, Georgia. It's about 45 minutes from here to go meet this condemned prisoner. And I got so nervous on the drive because I realized this man would be disappointed when he discovered that I was just a law student. And I tried to rehearse exactly what I was going to say, and I parked the car in the prison parking lot, and I walked inside, and I entered this prison, which was dark and intimidating, and they took me back to the visitation room, and I was pacing back and forth because I was getting more and more nervous, and And finally, after 10 minutes, they opened the door, and there stood the first condemned prisoner I'd ever seen. And what I remember about him is how burdened by chains he was. He had handcuffs on his wrist. He had shackles on his ankles. He had a chain around his waist. It took them 10 minutes to unchain this man. And the longer they took, the more nervous I became. And finally, when they had him unchained and he walked inside, I was so nervous, I just walked up to him and I said, "I'm so sorry." I said, "I'm just a law student. I don't know anything about the death penalty. I don't know anything about criminal procedure. I don't know anything about civil procedure. I don't know anything about appellate procedure. I don't know much about much, but they sent me down here to tell you that you're not at risk of execution anytime in the next week." And as soon as I said that, the man said, wait, say that again. I said, "You're not at risk of execution anytime in the next year." The man looked at me and he said, wait, say that again. I said, "You're not at risk of execution anytime in the next year." And that's when this man grabbed my hand and he said, thank you. He said, "You're the first person I've met in the 2 years that I've been on death row who's not a death row prisoner or a death row guard." He said, "I've been talking to my wife and kids on the phone, but I haven't let them come and visit." He said, "Now because of you, I'm going to see my wife and my kids. I didn't want them to have to deal with an execution, but if I'm not at risk for a year, I'm going to see my wife, I'm going to see my kids." He said, thank you. And I couldn't believe how even in my ignorance, being proximate could have an impact on the quality of someone's life, but it did. That man and I started talking. It turned out we were exactly the same age. We had the same birthday, same month, same day, same year. And he started asking me questions about my life and started asking questions about his life. And before I knew it, we were deep in conversation. 45 minutes turned into an hour turned into 2 hours, 2 hours turned into 3 hours, and we were still talking. The guards were sitting outside, and I'd only scheduled to be there an hour, and they were getting angry that I'd stayed so long. And finally, after 3 hours, these guards couldn't take it any longer. They came bursting into the room, and they were mad and angry. They couldn't do anything to me, so they took it out with this man. They threw him against the wall. And they started putting the handcuffs on his wrist so tightly I could see him grimacing in pain. I begged him to be gentle. I said, "Look, it's my fault, not his fault. Please don't be mad at him. It was my fault." They said they didn't pay me any mind. They then took the chain and he wrapped it around his waist so tightly. He put the shackles back on his ankles. I could see it pinching his skin. I begged them to be gentle, but they ignored me. The condemned man looked at me. He said, "Bryan, don't worry about this. You just come back." And then they started shoving this man toward the door. They almost knocked him down. And they were pushing him roughly toward the door, and I was watching in horror. But when he got near the door, I watched this condemned man plant his feet. And the next time they shoved him, he didn't move. And then he turned to me and he said, "Bryan, don't worry about this. You just come back." And then I watched that man do something I've never forgotten. I stood there and I watched him close his eyes. And then he threw his head back. And then he started to sing. And he started singing this hymn I used to hear all the time. He started singing, "I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I'm onward bound." And then he said, "Lord, plant my feet on higher ground." Everybody stopped. The guards were covered. They started pushing him down the hallway. You could hear the chains clanging, but you could also hear this man singing about higher ground. And I will tell you, hearing that man's song changed. In that moment, I knew I wanted to help condemned people get to higher ground. But more than that, I knew that my journey to higher ground was tied to his journey. I realized that if he doesn't get there, I can't get there. And I went back to Harvard Law School with a radicalized interest in the law. When I got back to law school, you couldn't get me out of the law school library. I needed to know everything about substantive due process, the procedural due process. Became deeply engaged in the study of law because I now wanted to get condemned people to higher ground, and proximity gave me that. And if we get proximate to the families and the communities in our cities, if we get proximate to the poor, if we get proximate to those who are experiencing inequality and injustice, if we get proximate to those in jails and prisons, and those who are coming out of jails and prisons, I believe we will find the power we need to change our communities, to create more justice. But proximity won't be enough by itself. The second thing I am persuaded that we have to do in this country is that we've got to change the narratives behind the problems that we are facing. You see, we have mass incarceration because we made some policy decisions. We decided to deal with drug addiction and drug dependency as a crime issue. We said people who are drug dependent, people who are drug addicted, we said they're criminals. Now, we could have said that that's a health problem. With regard to alcoholism, he said, well, that's a disease. And if you know somebody who's an alcoholic and you see them going into a bar, it would never occur to you to call the police. But with regard to drug addiction, he said, well, that's a crime. And because of that, we've put hundreds of thousands of people in jails and prisons, mostly people of color. But the reason why we made that policy choice has to do with a narrative. And the narrative is shaped by what I call the politics of fear and anger. For the last 50 years, our politicians have been preaching to us, be afraid and be angry. And they've used fear and anger to justify things that have sustained inequality. Fear and anger are things that we have to resist. Fear and anger are the essential ingredients of oppression, of inequality. If you go any place in the world where people are being oppressed, where people are being abused, and you ask the oppressors why they are doing what they do, they'll give you a narrative of fear and anger. And we've got to change that narrative if we want to change the world. I want to change the narrative about children in this country. Because we had criminologists 30, 40 years ago going around saying that we had a new species of child in America. And these criminologists were saying, we've got these new kids. They may look like kids, they may act like kids, they may sound like kids. They said, but don't be deceived. They said, these are not children. And they came up with a new word that demonized a generation of children in this country. They said, these aren't children. They came up with this word. They said, these are, quote, super predators. And they used that label. And that label changed our education policy. That label changed the criminal justice system. We began lowering the minimum age of trying children as adults. We put thousands of children in adult prisons. We've got 13 states today that have no minimum age of trying a child as an adult. I represent 9 and 10-year-old kids who are facing 40 and 50-year sentences. We sentenced children to die in prison. Schools changed. We began talking about zero tolerance, and we made our schools a pipeline. And the schoolhouse to jailhouse pipeline was constructed on the lie that some children are children. And one of the challenges that we face is that we've got to change that narrative. We've got too many schools in America where the teachers sound like correctional officers and the principals sound like wardens. We've got too many schools that don't offer love. But we're all with a threat and menace. And I want to tell you something about the kids that I work with. We've got 200 zip codes in this country where 80% of the children are expected to go to jail or prison. And what these children are suffering from is trauma. There's an epidemic of trauma in America. When you are born into a violent family and you live in a violent neighborhood and you go to a violent school and your life is shaped by violence and abuse and neglect and people constantly threatening you, it will traumatize you. And you'll come to school with these heightened levels of cortisol and adrenaline. And the thing we have to do for these children is that we've got to make them feel safe. But we're not doing that too often. We make them go through metal detectors. We've got uniformed police officers. We say, if you mess up, we'll suspend you. If you mess up twice, we'll expel you. And this threat and menace mindset, this narrative of threat and menace has to be changed. I don't believe that we can change the world through fear and intimidation. We've got to change the world through compassion and love. What these children need is someone to hold them and make them feel safe. I want to say to the Department of Education, when you judge schools in this country, when you measure schools, you can't just look at these performance test scores. I think you are not a good school in America. If you have high rates of suspension, if you have high rates of expulsion, you are not a good school. You are failing the children that most desperately need education. If we want to do something to measure schools, let's measure these suspension and expulsion rates. Let's make those a formal factor. Let's incentivize keeping the kids who most need education in school. We've got to change the narrative for the children who are most at risk. I worked on a case some years ago involving a 14-year-old boy who lived in a household where his mother had been the target of a lot of domestic violence. This boy's mother had a boyfriend. When this man would start drinking, he'd get violent. And one day the man had been drinking, he came home, he walked up to the kitchen, he called the boy's mother into the kitchen. He didn't say anything, he just walked up to this boy's mother and he punched her in the face. She fell down, she hit her head as she fell. She was on the floor, unconscious and bleeding. Her son came running into the kitchen to help his mom. He tried to get the bleeding to stop, he tried to get his mom to revive, but he couldn't. After 10 minutes, this child thought his mom was dead. She wasn't dead, he thought she was dead. The man had gone into a bedroom and fallen asleep, so the little boy got up and he walked into the bedroom. He was going to call the police, but then he remembered that this man kept a handgun in his dresser drawer. And so he walked over to that drawer and he opened it up and he pulled out the gun and he went over to where the man was sleeping and he pointed the gun at the man's head. The man was snoring. And when the man stopped snoring, this little boy panicked and he pulled the trigger and he shot this man in the head. This little boy was very small for his age. He was under 5 feet tall. He weighed less than 100 pounds. He'd never been in trouble before. He had no prior juvenile adjudications. He was a decent student. And he might have been tried as a juvenile, but for the fact that the man that he shot and killed, his mother's boyfriend, that man, was a deputy sheriff. And because he was a deputy sheriff, the prosecutor insisted that this child be tried as an adult. The judge immediately certified him to stand trial as an adult. He'd been in the jail 3 days before his mother and grandmother got me involved in the case. I went to the jail to see this little boy, and I was stunned to see this terrified child walk into the visitation room. He sat down, and I started asking him questions, but no matter what I asked him, he wouldn't say anything. He just sat there. I finally put my pen down. I said, "Look, I can't help you if you don't talk to me. You gotta talk to me." The little boy wouldn't say anything. He just kept sitting there. I got up. I walked around the table. I pulled my chair close. I said, "Come on, you gotta talk to me. I can't help you if you don't talk to me." And he kept staring at the wall. He wouldn't say a word. I couldn't figure out what to do. And after a few minutes, I decided to just lean on him. I don't even know why, but I leaned on him. And when I leaned on him, he leaned back. And when he leaned back, I put my arm around him and I said, "Come on, you gotta talk to me. I can't help you if you don't talk to me." And that's when this little boy started to cry. And through his tears, he began talking to me, not about what happened with the man, not about what happened with his mom, but he started talking to me about what had happened at the jail. He told me on the first night, several men had hurt him. He told me on the next night he'd been raped by several people. He told me on the night before I'd gotten there, so many people had hurt him, he couldn't remember how many there had been. And I held this little boy while he cried hysterically for almost an hour. I finally got him calm. I said, "Look, you stay right here. I'm going to get you out of here." And I never will forget trying to leave that jail. That little boy grabbing me by the arm so tightly. He said, "Please don't go. Please, please don't go." I said, "No, it's okay. It's all right. You stay right here. I'm going to get you out of here." And I left that jail, and the question I had in my mind when I left that jail was, who is responsible for this? And the answer is, we are. We are. We've allowed narratives to emerge in this country that some children aren't children, and we, particularly us, those of us in education, those of us who are proximate to children, those of us who know and understand, we've got to change this narrative. All children are children. And we will not do well in this country. We cannot claim to be protected. So we understand what that means is serving the children who are most vulnerable. We have to judge our success as educators, not by how we do with privileged, talented, ultra-prepared students. We have to judge our success as educators by looking at how we deal with students who are dealing with disabilities and struggles and trauma and neglect. I think our commitment to children, our investment in children, cannot be measured by looking at how we treat the privileged children, the powerful children, the affluent children. We have to look at how we treat the poor children. Measure of our commitment. We've got to change this narrative. I also think we have to change the narrative about race. You see, I don't think we're free in America. The reason why we have to have this conference, the reason why we have to gather in this way, is because we are burdened by a history of racial inequality in this country. And that history of racial inequality has created a kind of smog. It's in the air, and we've all been breathing it in our whole lives, and because of it, none of us is free. Not just people of color, no one is free. We are compromised, we are infected by this history of racial inequality. And to get better, to deal with this history, we've got to talk about some things we haven't talked about. We've got to address this fundamental problem of our history of racial inequality. I think we have to talk about the fact that we are a post-genocide society. Before white settlers came to this continent, there was millions of native people all around Georgia, all around the South, all around the Midwest. We've got all of these Indian names for rivers and streams and counties and places, but the people have been rounded up and pushed aside. We killed them by the millions through famine and war and disease. We slaughtered native people, and it was a genocide, but we didn't call it a genocide. We said we didn't have to call it a genocide because those people were different.
We said their racial difference made it not a genocide. We said, no, those aren't people. We said, those are savages. And that narrative of racial difference is what we use to shield ourselves from doing the things you're supposed to do when you're a post-genocide society. When you're a post-genocide society, there are things you have to do, and we haven't done them. And that narrative of racial difference was the problem that gave rise to centuries of slavery. And I don't think the great evil of American slavery was involuntary servitude or forced labor. I believe the great evil of American slavery was the narrative of racial difference that we created to legitimate it. Our slave owners didn't just want to be slave owners, they wanted to be moral, just, and Christian slave owners. So they created this ideology of white supremacy to legitimate the slaves that they took. And that narrative of racial difference, that ideology of white supremacy, that was the great evil of American slavery. If you read the 13th Amendment, it doesn't talk about narratives of racial difference. It doesn't talk about white supremacy. It only talks about involuntary servitude and forced labor. And because of that, I don't think slavery ended in 1865. I think it just evolved. Of color were pulled out of their homes. They were hung and beaten and burned alive and mutilated. And this terror shaped our nation. Decades of terrorism. And no one did anything. No one said anything. And that terror weighed on people and weighed on people and changed the demographic geography of America. Old people of color come up to me sometimes. They say, Mr. Stevenson, I get angry when I hear somebody on TV talking about how we're dealing with domestic terrorism for the first time in our nation's history after 9/11. And so we grew up with terror. We grew up being bombed and lynched and menaced every day of our lives. Those of you who work in urban communities in the North and West need to understand that these communities were shaped by terror. The black people that went to Cleveland and Chicago and Detroit and Los Angeles and Oakland and Newark and New York and Minneapolis and Boston did not go to these communities as immigrants looking for new economic opportunities. They came to these communities as refugees and exiles from terror in the American South. And in the national context, if you're dealing with a refugee community, there are these needs that have to be addressed. We've got to deal with the trauma. We've got to deal with the burdens. We've got to deal with all of that stress. But we didn't do that in the urban North and West. We played it off. And that narrative hasn't been addressed. And then we get into the civil rights movement, where people courageously resisted and stand up to fight back. And it's important that we celebrate those who did that. But I worry when we teach civil rights in this country, I worry that we're too celebratory. I hear people talking about the civil rights movement. And you know, everybody gets to celebrate the civil rights movement. It doesn't matter what you think or what you do or how you act, you get to celebrate. And it worries me. I hear people teaching the civil rights movement and it's starting to sound like a three-day carnival. On day one, those marks that we get the first seat on the bus. On day two, Dr. King led a march on Washington. And on day three, we changed all the laws of racism. That's not history. But that's not our history. Our history is that for decades in this country, we said to black people, you can't vote just because you're black. We said to black people, you can't go to school because you're black. My parents were humiliated every day of their lives. They'd see these signs that said white and color. They weren't directions. They were assaults. They were injuries. And we haven't treated these injuries. We should have committed ourselves to a process of truth and reparations in the 1960s, but we didn't do it. We played it off, and now that narrative of racial difference is still alive. It's still manifesting itself. And I don't have to tell any of this because you already know it. Today, there is a burden. There is a presumption of dangerousness and guilt that burdens every person of color in this country. When you go places, it doesn't matter how talented you are. It doesn't even matter how educated you are. It doesn't matter how good you are, how kind you are. You can go places in this country where you will be presumed dangerous and guilty just by your color. Why the problem of police violence is so vexing and devastating. It is a lethal manifestation of this presumption of dangerousness and guilt. And it doesn't matter where you go. I've been practicing law for 30-some years. I've argued these cases in the U.S. Supreme Court. And I was in a courtroom not too long ago in the Midwest. Had my suit and tie on. I was sitting there at defense counsel's table. I was there for the first time in this courtroom. And the judge walked in and saw me sitting at defense counsel's table. And he said, hey. You get back out there in the hallway, you wait until your client gets here, and your lawyer gets here. I don't want any defendants sitting in my courtroom without their lawyer. And I stood up and I said, well, I'm sorry, Your Honor, I didn't introduce myself. My name is Bryan Stevenson. I am the lawyer. And the judge started laughing. And the prosecutor started laughing. And I made myself laugh because I didn't want to disadvantage my client. The client came and a young white kid was representing. Afterward, I was sitting there thinking, what is it? And then this judge saw a middle-aged black man in a suit and tie sitting at defense counsel's table. It didn't even occur to him that might be the lawyer. That what that is this narrative of racial difference, and we've got to change the narrative. If you go to South Africa, you can't spend time there without hearing about the legacy of apartheid. South Africans will make you understand what apartheid is like. If you go to Rwanda, you can't go there without hearing about the challenges created by the genocide. They will make you understand the legacy of the genocide. If you go to Germany today, you can't go to Berlin, Germany, and go 100 meters without seeing a marker or a stone that's been placed next to the home of a Jewish family that was abducted during the Holocaust. The Germans want you to go to the memorials. They want you to go to the Holocaust memorial. They want you to talk about and understand that legacy. But in this country, we don't talk about slavery. We don't talk about redemption. We don't talk about slavery. Bodies of thousands of people who died from enslavement. We're sitting next to places where surrounding us, hundreds of people were lynched, mutilated, burned alive, and we are silent about that. We've got to change that narrative. We have a project at the Equal Justice Initiative. We're putting up markers in every lynching site in America. We want to go every place in this country. Your students, if you're living in a county where people were lynched and we don't know about where those lynchings are, I don't think we can actually get to the kind of understanding that we need to create a just nation until we understand the burden of slavery, the burden of the genocide. We brought some calendars here. I hope you'll take them. I hope you'll go to our site and use these materials. I hope you'll partner with us and find ways to engage in this narrative changing work. I believe we cannot change the world without changing this narrative. We're going to build a museum in Montgomery. It's going to open next summer. It's called From Enslavement to Mass Incarceration. It's not going to be a happy celebratory thing. It's going to be a museum designed to make you walk through it. And when you come out, when you go to the Holocaust Memorial, you come out and you say never again. But we need to begin saying never again about the genocide. Never again. Have to change the narrative, but even that won't be enough. The third thing we have to do, it's not going to be enough just to be proximate and change the narrative. The third thing I'm persuaded we have to do is we have to stay hopeful. And I say that because I really do believe it's important that you protect your hopefulness. You cannot allow yourself to become hopeless. Hopelessness is the enemy of justice. Injustice prevails where hopelessness persists. And when you become hopeless, you become part of the problem. It's not even that you're neutral, you're part of the problem. Hope is essential for changing the world. It is essential for justice work because hope is what gets you to stand up when other people say sit down. Hope is what gets you to speak when other people say be quiet. Without hope, you cannot do the things that we need to do in this country. So you've got to identify the things that make you hopeless and you've got to protect yourself. You've got to battle with those things. And I can't tell you what makes you hopeless. I'll tell you a little bit about what makes me hopeless. When I leave here, I'm going to drive back to Montgomery, Alabama. That's where I live. It's probably the worst place in America for me to live. And I say that because the thing that really challenges my whole dynamic, the thing that really provokes me, is that I really do not like it when people start trying to glorify the past, when we start talking about the good old days of the 40s and 50s, when we try to romanticize our history when it's not romantic, when people talk about the good old days of the 1900s, the early 1900s, it provokes me. In my state of Alabama, Father Jefferson Davis's birthday is a state holiday. Confederate Memorial Day is a state holiday. We don't even have Martin Luther King Day in Alabama. We have Martin Luther King / Robert E. Lee Day. Our two largest high schools are Robert E. Lee High and Jefferson Davis High. I cannot identify a decade in American history since we were founded as a country that I think we would want to repeat, where I can claim that's when America was great. I can't find that decade when I look backward. I want to make America great. It's You spend some time here in Georgia, in this region, you're going to see these things. I went to a prison some years ago, and I parked my car in the prison parking lot. There was a truck in the prison parking lot, and it was like a shrine to the Old South. This truck had about 10 Confederate flags on it. I don't know why you need 10 flags. It had all of these bumper stickers. It had a gun. It had all the, that stuff. And I went up to this truck. There were actually bumper stickers on this truck I'd never seen before. And I went up to this truck, and I looked at it. There was a bumper sticker on this truck that read, quote, "If I'd known it was going to be like this, I'd have picked my own cop." I hadn't seen that one before. And I was provoked by this truck, and I went to the door, and it was a white guard at the door, and I went up there and said, "Hi, my name is Bryan Stevenson. I'm here for legalism." And a man said, "Needed you to me." He said, "You're not a lawyer." I said, "Oh, yes, sir, I am. I've been to this prison before." He said, "I don't believe you're a lawyer. Where's your bar card?" I said, "I've never needed to show my bar card to get into this prison." He said, "Well, I'm not letting you in here without a bar card." And the man made me go back to my car to get my bar card. I was insulted. I came back, I showed him the card. I said, "Look, I want to see my client." And the man said, "Well, you've got a bar card, but you're still going to get in that bathroom. I'm going to make you submit to a strip search before I let you in." I said, "No, sir, lawyers don't get strip search." He said, "Well, you're not coming into my prison unless you get in that bathroom." Couldn't find anybody to help me. Nobody would intervene. And after a lot of back and forth, I went into the bathroom and subjected myself to this humiliating strip search. I came back out trying to recover some dignity. I said, "Look, I want to see my client now." And the man said, "You've got to go back there and sign the book." I said, "Lawyers don't have to sign that book." He said, "You come into my prison, you go back there and sign the book." So I did. And finally, this man took me over to the door, and I was just trying to get away from him. And he unlocked the door, and I tried to walk past him, but he grabbed me by the arm. He said, "Hey, let me ask you something." He said, "Did you see that truck out there with all of those flags and bumper stickers?" I said, "Yeah, I saw that truck." He said, "I want you to know, that's my truck." I was in the visitation room, angry, waiting for this client to come out, somebody I'd never met before. And finally, this young client comes out, a young African-American man. He comes out, he sits down, and the first thing this client says to me when he sits down is, quote, "Did you bring me a chocolate milkshake?" And I thought to myself, this is the strangest day I've ever had. I said, "No, I didn't bring you a chocolate milkshake. I'm your lawyer. I'm here to represent you." I started asking my questions, and then I realized he wasn't paying attention. So I put my pen down. I said, "Oh, man, I'm sorry. I didn't realize you wanted me to bring you a chocolate milkshake. The next time I come, if they let me, I'll bring you a chocolate milkshake." And that's when this man smiled and smiled and smiled. And I realized he was severely disabled. It turned out that he had been in 29 foster homes by the time he was 10. At the age of 13, he began showing symptoms of bipolar disorder. He couldn't get medical care, so he started using crack cocaine. At the age of 15, he was using heroin. At 16, he showed symptoms of schizophrenia. At 17, he was homeless. At 18, he began having psychotic episodes. At 19, in the midst of a psychotic episode, he was on the street and a man walked by. His client thought he was about to be attacked by a demon. It was just a man walking by, but he stabbed that man to death. He was charged with capital murder. He was quickly convicted, quickly sentenced to death. I got the trial transcript. I read through it. I couldn't find the words mental health, mental illness, mental disease, mental disability anywhere in that transcript. He was terribly offended. And one of the challenges that we have in our criminal justice system is that we have a system that treats you better if you're rich and guilty than if you're poor and innocent. A presentation from the court. We had experts and witnesses who would come and testify. And it was time to go to court, which was a couple of hours from the prison. And I explained to my client I was never able to bring him a chocolate milkshake. I said, "I need you to pay attention." He said, "I'll try." I was about to start the hearing when I turned around, and lo and behold, who do I see in the courtroom? Had gone. Hadn't seen him since that one encounter. He was just glaring at me. I said, "I'm not going to be distracted by that guy." We put on our witnesses, and we put on our case, and over the next 3 days, I was pleased to see the judge paying attention, and I was getting hopeful about what we might do for this young man. And about a month after the hearing, I decided to go visit him. And I drove down to the prison, and I parked my car in the prison parking lot. And I was walking inside, and lo and behold, what do I see in the parking lot? That truck. And I was having one of those days where I just didn't think I could put up with a lot of foolishness. So I said, "You know what? I drove 2 hours to get here, but I'm not going to deal with that guy today. I'm going to come back another day." And I turned around, I actually go back to my car, but when I turned around, I started hearing that song. We used to sing all the time. We used to sing the song where they'd say, "Can't let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around." And I realized I wasn't supposed to turn around. So I got my bar card and I went up to the front door, and sure enough, that guard was there. I said, "Hi, my name is Bryan Stevenson." And the man immediately cut me off. He said, "Hello, Mr. Stevenson, how are you?" I said, I'm fine, here's my marker. He said, I don't need to see that. I said, well, thank you, I'll go in the bathroom, get ready for your search. He said, we're not going to do that today. I said, well, thank you. He said, I'll go back here and sign the book. He said, Mr. Stevenson, I saw you coming, and I signed you in. I said, thank you. He turned around to take me to the door, and I was walking to the door trying to figure out what is going on. And I was sort of walking kind of lightly off my feet because I knew something bad was going on. I was really confused following this guy. We got over to the door, and I watched this man reach into his pocket and pull the keys out. And then he tried to unlock the door, but his hands started shaking so badly he could not get the key in the lock. And I was staring at him, watching his hands shake, couldn't figure out what was going on. And finally, after a few minutes, he got his hands steady enough to put the key in the lock, and he unlocked the door, and he turned around, and his face was bright red. And then he said to me, he said, Mr. Stevenson, stop, I've got to save you. I just stood there. He said, I need to tell you something. He said, I was in that courtroom when you did that hearing for those 3 days. I was listening. He said, I want to tell you something. He said, I want you to know that I came up in the foster care system too. He said, I had it really, really bad. He said, I didn't think anybody had it as bad as I did, but I realized listening that maybe your client had it worse than I did. And then this man looked at me. He said, Mr. Stevenson, there's something I want to say to you. He said, I've been thinking about this, and I'm glad you're here. He said, I want you to know that I think what you're doing is a good thing. And then this man looked at me and he said, Mr. Stevenson, I hope you keep fighting for justice. He put his hand out and said, sir, can I please shake your hand? I would have never, ever thought it possible. I shook his hand and said, this means a lot to me, thank you. He said, no, sir, I hope you keep fighting for justice. I turned and go into the prison to see the client and he grabbed me by the arm and said, wait, I gotta tell you something else. I said, what's that? So I just want you to know, on the way back from the courthouse to the prison, I did something. I said, what'd you do? He said, well, on the way back to the prison, I decided to take an exit, and I took your client to a Wendy's, and I bought him a chocolate milk. We have to stay focused. When people say, well, those people can't do this, and these people can't do that, and those people will never be this, and these people will never be that, and we've got to have enough hopeful people in this country to say, I don't believe that. When they say these children cannot learn, these children can't be changed, these children can't be turned around, there's got to be enough hopeful educators to wrap their arms around those children to say, I don't accept that. And our hope is what gets us there. 45. Being proximate and changing narratives and saying hope. The fourth and final thing we've got to do if we're going to change the world, that we've got to be willing to do uncomfortable things. And I hate saying it because I know it's hard. We're human, we like comfort. And I understand that, but I am persuaded that we cannot change the world until we decide that we're going to do uncomfortable things. And we've got to make a decision because we're biologically and psychologically propelled to do what's comfortable. And to do what's uncomfortable means we have to push ourselves, we've got to will ourselves to do the uncomfortable. And believe me, I wish it wasn't like this. I've done some research on this. I've tried to find examples where oppression was ended, where justice prevailed, where equality triumphed, where nobody had to do anything inconvenient or uncomfortable. I can't find any examples of that. It only happens when people do the uncomfortable and the inconvenient. And don't get me wrong, I'm not speaking against comfort. I like comfort, I'm not against comfort. I gave a talk down in Mississippi, and people met me at the airport. They said, oh, Mr. Stevenson, we know all about you. We know what kind of lawyer you are, we read your book, we know what kind of work you do. We have to tell you that we're having our conference at the luxurious DoubleTree Hotel. And we decided that you would not want to stay at the luxurious DoubleTree Hotel. They said, so we've asked one of the farmers to put you up at the bar. I said, what is wrong with you? Just like everybody else. And what I'm talking about is sometimes you have to position yourself in uncomfortable places. And you've got to be a witness. I have the great privilege of winning freedom for people. And a client spent 30 years in death row for crime and did not commit. And it was overwhelming at times. And we kept fighting. And last year that man walked out of death row free, and we have these days, we talk to each other all the time, and he travels around, and he's experiencing freedom, and it's so incredibly uplifting. But I will also tell you, we've had some difficult days. When I leave here today, I'm going back to Alabama, where tonight a man is scheduled for execution. And when we have executions in Alabama, they can be overwhelming. A few years ago, we had an outbreak of executions. Every other month, somebody was facing execution. And we don't have a right to counsel in this country for people on death row. We don't provide the right to death row visitors as a matter of constitutional right. And so we made the commitment to represent everybody facing execution without a lawyer. And I watched my young lawyers get beat down by these executions, and I felt bad. I said, you know what, you all take a break, I'll take the next one. And I got involved in a case involving a man who was scheduled to be executed in 30 days, and I got the records, and I quickly learned that he suffered from intellectual disability. He had mental retardation, and our courts had banned the execution of people with mental retardation. So I went to the trial court and said, you can't execute him, he suffers from intellectual disability. But the trial judge said it's too late, it should have been raised earlier. I said, it's not too late. The trial judge said, no, too late. And I went to the state court, they said too late. The appeals court said too late. The federal court said too late. Every court we went to said too late. One of the challenges that we have in our legal system is that our courts are sometimes more committed to finality than fairness. And on the day of this execution, I was waiting for a ruling from the Supreme Court. I kept pacing back and forth in my office. And finally, about an hour before the execution, the phone rang. And it was the clerk of court from the United States Supreme Court telling me that our motion for a stay of execution had been considered by the court, distributed to the members, and the court's judgment was that the stay motion was due to be denied. Too late. I hung up the phone and I picked it back up to call this man, and the hardest thing I have to do is say to someone facing execution, and I said it to this man, I said, I'm so sorry, I cannot stop this execution. And that's when this man started to cry. And then he began to sob. And I was holding the phone, and this man was just sobbing. And it was so painfully uncomfortable. And then he said something to me. He said, Mr. Stevenson, I got something really important that I have to say to you. He said, please don't hang up until I tell you what I have to tell you. And I said, of course. And then this man tried to say something to me, but in addition to being intellectually disabled, he had another challenge. When he got nervous, when he got overwhelmed, he began to stutter. A speech impediment that would manifest itself, and all of a sudden he could not get out a single word. I was standing there holding the phone while this man, through his tears, was trying to say something. He kept trying to form a word. He kept trying to get his brain and his mouth to get together. He kept trying to get a word out, but he couldn't. And he kept trying, and he kept trying. And the guards were trying to rush him, which just made it worse. He kept trying, and he kept trying. And the harder he tried to talk and fail, the more he was just ripping my heart. Before I realized it, tears were running down my face. I was just standing there in agony, painfully uncomfortable. And then my mind wandered a little bit. I remembered how when I was 9 or 10 years old, I'd gone to church one Sunday, and my friends and I were talking, my brother and I were talking to these kids standing in front of us, and there was this little skinny kid who wasn't saying anything. And I remember looking to that little boy and saying, what's your name, where are you from? And then the night of this execution, I remembered how that little boy also couldn't get his words out. He stuttered and couldn't get his words out, and then I remember him doing something really ignorant. I laughed. And my mother was standing across the room, and she saw me laughing at this little boy. And she gave me this look I'd never seen before. And she came over and grabbed me by the arm, and she pulled me aside. She said, Bryan, don't you ever laugh at somebody because they can't get their words out, right? Don't you ever do that. And I tried to apologize. Even then, I was a little bit of a young lawyer. I said, well, Mom, I couldn't hear. I wasn't sure. I wasn't clear. My mother said, no, you know better than that. And then she looked at me and she said, then you go back over there and you tell that little boy you're sorry. I said, okay, Mom. And I took a step at my mom, grabbed her by the arm. She said, wait, after you tell that little boy you're sorry, I want you to hug that little boy. I sort of rolled my eyes. I said, okay, Mom. And I took a step and then she grabbed her by the arm again. She said, wait, after you hug that little boy, I want you to tell that little boy you love him. I said, Mom, I can't go over there and tell that little boy. She gave me that look again, so I said, all right, all right. None of this execution, what I remember was walking over to this little boy and saying, look, man, I'm sorry. And then I remember sort of lunging at him, giving my little boy version of a man hug. And then I remember trying to say to this child as insincerely as I possibly could. I said, look, man, I love you. And what I forgot until that night was how that little boy hugged me back. And then I remembered how he whispered flawlessly in my ear, he said, I love you too. And I was thinking about that while this man was trying to get his words out. Finally, this condemned man got his words, and he said, Mr. Stevenson, I want to thank you for fighting for me. want to thank you for representing me. The last thing that man said to me was, Mr. Stevenson, I love you for trying to save my life. He hung up the phone, they pulled him away, they strapped him to a gurney, and they executed him. I hung up the phone and said, I can't do this anymore. It's too hard, too painful, too uncomfortable. I kept thinking about how broken he was. The question I had in my mind was, why do we want to kill all the broken people in this country? What is it about us that when we see brokenness, we want to crush it and hurt it and throw it away? It's the broken children that are the first to be discarded. I don't understand it. And then I realized, all of my clients are broken people. I represent the broken. My clients have been broken by poverty, broken by racism, broken by neglect, broken by abuse, broken by despair. And then I realized that I work in a broken system. The people who have power are unwilling to get proximate. They're rooted in narratives of fear and anger. They've lost their hope. They won't do uncomfortable things. I said, you know what? I don't have anything more to do with this. And I sat down trying to reconcile myself to not doing this work anymore. And I was just sitting there. And something told me, you've got to think about why you've been doing what you've been doing. And I just sat there for a while. And then all of a sudden, I had this realization that shocked me. All of a sudden, I realized why I do what I do, and it was a shock. What I realized is that I don't do what I do because I've been trained to do it. I don't do what I do because if I don't do it, no one will. I don't do what I do because it's about justice. I don't do what I do because I sometimes get to talk to wonderful people like you. I don't do what I do because somebody's got to do it. I realized that night something I'd never realized before, and what I realized is that I do what I do because I'm broken too. And the truth is that if you get proximate, if you change narratives, if you stay hopeful, if you do uncomfortable things, it will break you. But I'm a witness this morning that there's power in brokenness. It's the broken that understand how compassion works. It's the broken that understand how mercy works. It's the broken that understand how justice works. There's no shame in it. To resurrect these spaces in America where people have been thrown away, if we break ourselves to embrace the children who most need and require education to change our lives, if we break ourselves to make a difference in the world, that's how we change the world. I believe really simple things. I believe that each person, each child especially, is more than the worst thing they've ever done. I think if somebody tells a lie, they're not just a liar. I think if someone takes something, they're not just a thief. I think even if you kill someone, you're not just a killer. And justice requires we know the other things you are. I believe in this country that the opposite of poverty is not wealth. We talk sometimes too much about money. I am persuaded that in this country the opposite of poverty is wealth. I believe the opposite of poverty is justice. And when we do justice, we begin to create conditions for better reputation than we live in. And finally, I believe that when I come to Atlanta, when I come to the communities where many of you work and serve, we cannot judge how we're doing in our communities. We can't judge our character. We can't judge our commitment to the rule of law. We can't judge our commitment to education by looking at how we treat the privileged and the powerful. We've got to look at how we treat the poor, the incarcerated, and the condemned. And it's in that context that I believe there's important work to be done, but that we can do it. We've just got to get proximate. We've got to change these narratives. We've got to stay hopeful. We've got to do uncomfortable things. I'll end with this. There's a different metric system for the students and the educators that are trying to change the world. You can't judge yourself the way a lot of other people want to judge you. Don't look at yourself through that lens. I want to say to all of the students who are here, I want you to study hard. I really do. I want you to put as much information and knowledge in your head as possible. We need you to be smart and innovative and creative. But I also want to say to each and every one of you that those ideas in your mind have to be fueled by some conviction in your heart. Don't neglect what's in your heart as you make your way through schools. I also need to say, as hard as I want you to study, as well as I want you to do, I also want you to know that your capacity to change the world will never be judged by the grades you get. Your grades are not a motivator. To the students who are working in places and in spaces where there are difficulties, where there's not always a lot of accolades, where there's not always a lot of positive reinforcement, I want you to create the best school we can. It does matter how our children perform. It does matter how they succeed. I want you to have good jobs. I want you to be able to take care of your families. But I also need to tell you that your income is not a measure of your capacity to change the world. It's not. Our capacity to change the world is measured by something else. An older man taught me this. I was giving a talk in a church, and this older man came into the back of the church. He was in a wheelchair, an older black man. When he came into the church, he was looking at me with this stern, almost angry look on his face. I couldn't figure out why he was looking at me so sternly. And he kept staring at me. He wouldn't smile, he just kept staring. And I got through my talk, and people came up. They were very nice and friendly, but that old man was sitting in the back, still staring at me. And finally, when everybody else left, this older man got a kid to wheel him down to the front of the church. And he came down the aisle of that church with this stern, angry look on his face. When he got in front of me, he put his hand up. He said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And I just stood there. And then he said it again. He said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And I just stepped back and I mumbled something. And then that older man said it one more time. He said, "Do you know what you're doing?" And then he looked at me. He said, "I'm going to tell you what you're doing." And then that older man looked at me. He said, "You're beating the drum for justice. You keep beating the drum for justice." And I was so moved, so moved. I was also waiting to leave because I just didn't know. Then this man grabbed me by my jacket and he pulled me into his wheelchair. He said, "Come here, come here, come here. I want to show you something." And this older man turned his head. He said, "You see the scar I have behind my right ear?" He said, "I got that scar in Greene County, Alabama, 1963, trying to rescue people to the boat." He turned and said, "You see this cut I have down here at the bottom of my neck? Got that cut in Philadelphia, Mississippi, 1964, trying to rescue people to the boat." He turned his head, he said, "You see this dark spot?" He said, "That's my bruise, got my bruise in Birmingham, Alabama, 1965, trying to register people to vote." He said, "I'm going to tell you something, young man." He said, "People look at me. They think I'm some old man sitting in a wheelchair covered with cuts and bruises and scars." He said, "But I'm going to tell you something." He said, "These aren't my cuts." He said, "These aren't my bruises." He said, "These aren't my scars." He said, "These are my medals of honor." You see, that we better honor what it means to change this country, to create education for every child in this country, than to break ourselves getting proximate, changing narrative, staying hopeful, and doing uncomfortable things. You have honored me by inviting me to be a part of this incredible gathering. And I just want to thank you for that honor. I want to thank you for this convening. I want to thank you for this opportunity. But mostly, I want to thank you for standing and fighting for our children who need you most. I wish you all the best. God bless you.